And then you can edit that out, right? Hang on.
Yeah. Affects it. Now there's only one side.
Okay.
Just to let you know.
There you go. And we're on up in Lejeune too. We're on up in Jacksonville and all that, so they'll be awesome.
You're listening to the T&A Morning Show.
All right, 9:41, the T&A Show. It's Tommy and Korby. Paul Yurkin is a former Marine, former police officer, and now an author. He's got a new book. It's called Memoirs of a Security Contractor. Now, you joined the Marines, what, back in 88, Paul?
That's right, yeah.
Nice, man. Hey, appreciate you being here, buddy.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you for your service, too, buddy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So you get out of the Corps. How long did you do in the Corps, man?
4 years.
Okay, did 4 years for old Chesty Fuller, did you?
Oh, yeah.
Nice. So you get out of the Corps. Did you have plans? I'm trying to lead up to how you come from being a grunt in the Marines to writing a book, because I don't even know where I would begin. I've had a million ideas that I thought would be great book ideas. You actually went through it. So you get out of the Marines. Do you immediately jump into the police department or?
No, what happened was I met some contacts and I started doing security at Grand Strand Hospital.
Oh, okay.
And my dream was always to want to be a police officer.
Yeah. And are you a local? Are you to Myrtle Beach, the Myrtle Beach area?
No, I'm from Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Shout out to my homies.
It sounds
listening.
Very hard, very hardcore in PA. So okay. So now you get out of
from
the Corps.
The ghetto to
from the ghetto. That's right. So
they must have been falling all over themselves to have a former Marine to come and be part of the security team at a hospital.
Oh, they were loving it. Plus, I was the youngest guy there. Everybody else was pretty much on their deathbed.
Okay, nice. Well, they didn't have far to go then at the hospital. Just wheel them down.
True story.
Them.
Yeah.
So, all right. So you do that, and then you just figure out that you this isn't enough. I want to be a cop now. So you have to go through the law enforcement training and all that. You become a police officer here in our home market, Myrtle Beach.
Correct. Yes.
So how long did you do that?
15 and a half years.
Whoa! Wow.
What's
look
wrong
at you.
With you?
Everything.
Do you feel like, as a cop, that you, like bringing your Marine Corps experience in it, because you're a combat Marine, coming in and the differences, because I have a lot of police friends as well, and I've always thought that, as tough as being the Marine, being a Marine and all that brings in, sometimes being a police officer has to be a lot, it's got to be a lot tougher, because of, you don't know, there's no open enemy in the field. I mean, you don't know who's, got what going on. You have to deal with civilian casualties and stuff. It's got to be mentally, maybe a little bit tougher than in some parts of being a Marine.
Well, in the Marine Corps, you know who your enemy is.
Yeah.
Because you're going to that country, and you know who's against you. Policing, you don't know on car stops what their mindset is, who wants to do what. So you rely on police training, you rely on common sense.
Yeah.
To try and get through the stop or get through the domestic violence call or whatever you're on.
Yeah. So you don't know on any given night, you have no idea what's going on.
No idea.
So, all right. So police force, 15 years, and then you go into private contracting overseas.
Correct.
So did you just get a better offer? They reach out to you because this is it like a Blackwater kind of a deal?
No, it's not. The company I was with, a lot of my friends were going in. It was that time of the year, that time of the decade when everybody was going to contracting, the money was good.
Yeah.
So they said, with all your experience, you can be a good contractor. So I started applying for companies, and one company I'm not going to mention reached out. I applied. It was probably the easiest process, according to them, that had ever happened.
Right.
So I wound up going to training in Virginia. From Virginia, I went over to Afghanistan. And
right back into the frying pan.
Right back into it, that's right.
Good night. Hadn't you had enough, man? You did a little combat over there. You've dealt with jerks on the road all the time. And I would go work at like a train depot or something. you know, something a lot easier to deal with, but you wanted to go right back into the heat.
Well, my type A got the best of me.
I got you.
It's
very,
in your
very nice.
Blood. It's in your blood, right?
That's right. That's exactly right.
Talking to Paul Yurkin. He's a former police officer, and he's written a book called Memoirs of a Security Contractor. At what point during this job, because you've done two very interesting jobs already, what about this job made you want to write a book about it?
Well, I started it as a log, because I wanted to keep track of everything I did while I was going through the contracting and the training, and I just want to have something to fall back on. You know, in policing, you dot your I's, cross your T's all the time, so that's what I wanted to do. And as I got to Afghanistan, I realized this could be something more.
Yeah.
So then, with the downtime that I had, I started turning it into a book.
Okay.
So why did you think that, you know, I mean, there's a lot of military. There's a lot of guys that go through maybe like the same situations that you go through a lot. Why did you think that your story would get out there, and why did you write it?
Well, there were some similarities, I'm sure, with a lot of the Marines, but your ability to articulate what everybody has gone through, I'm sure, helped you write the book.
Well, to answer what Korby said, I'm just a guy. You know, I'm a guy from the projects. Then I'm just a cop.
Yeah.
And blue collar guy. I wanted to tell my story from that side of it. You know, there's no special operations, there's no none of that. I just wanted to tell my side of the story on what just an average guy who's trying to make a difference for himself and his kids goes through in Afghanistan or contracting.
Okay, so that's it goes from like day one. Is it like a log book kind of a feel, like a day-to-day kind of a vibe, so you can just kind of you know, experience that, you know, from the book, what it's like to be over there?
Right, exactly. It started off being as a log, so when I went to a publisher, I had to tweak it a little bit, and instead of saying he, I had to turn it into I, so I was doing all these things.
Okay, gotcha. Very nice.
So when is the book coming out? I mean, when do we get to read the book?
Well, that's a good question. All my friends keep asking me the same thing because they keep seeing Facebook posts, and they're getting a little tired of the Facebook posts.
Right, yeah.
According to Amazon, it should be out the second week of September.
Okay, very nice.
Are there any excerpts from it that we can, will that come out during, in the Amazon, on Amazon?
No, wait for the book, Korby. I'll read the excerpts.
Look, here's the thing. I want to know a little bit. You know, where's the tease, Paul?
All right, real simple. Here's the tease.
Read it.
No, not at all. Basically, you know, I'm at the airport. I'm getting ready to leave in Myrtle Beach. I got my girls with me. Shout out Hannah and Lily, I love you. And, you know, it was so hard to just turn away and leave at that age. And telling them, Dad's coming back, don't worry. I had no idea if I was coming back or not.
Sure, sure.
No one does.
Yeah.
And so I get to training, I get to Afghanistan. And I knew it was real when the first mortar goes off, and I'm behind this Jersey type 10-foot HESCO barrier, and I can feel the concussion coming through, and I had that look on my face. I'm like, yeah, this just got real.
Yeah.
And so, you know, after the rockets get shot at you and everybody's trying to kill you, then you realize, I'm in Afghanistan.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
was there a moment that you thought to yourself, what the F did I do, man? Why did I come over here? Is there a point where you regretted it?
I never regretted it.
Okay.
Even to this day, I have I sustained an injury.
Yeah.
I have 8 screws in my neck, and I do it all over again.
So, because when you're in the Marines, as you know, you feel like you're fighting for country, you're fighting for the Corps, you're fighting for your buddies. What's the driving force as a contractor? What kind of solidifies the unit and is the grounding rod for yourself being over there?
Well, it's a better way of life for my children, for myself to put money away. And I was told, well, if you're dead, they're not going to see you. And I understand that. But, you know, even in policing,
anything can
happen.
True, fair
enough. And all law enforcement officers out there, you know, everything that's going on today, my hat goes off to my brothers and sisters. But it's anything can happen at any time. So when I was in Afghanistan, the thought never really occurred to me that I can die. Just finish the mission, get home.
So as a contractor, did you get to choose what you wanted to do, or do they tell you this is what we need you to do, and then we'll send you over there, and then you say yes or no?
Great question. I applied for a specific contract.
Okay.
And that contract was to train Afghan police.
Okay.
And when I finished that contract, another contract came up which was
something else.
I forgot the name of the contract.
Oh, okay.
Oh, personal security. I'm
okay.
Sorry.
Okay, gotcha.
I didn't know if you
security.
Could say it or not.
No, I could. So it was personal security. So I started doing that for about 4 months, which was a dream job.
Okay. Don't you feel like training those Afghan soldiers, though? It's almost making them tougher to fight the next 10 minutes when we have to go back over there and fight again. I remember, you know, a few years ago, they were throwing rocks at tanks, and now they've got our weapons and some of our training, and they won't, you know, they'll never be the Marines or, you know, even the soldiers that the American people, and there are good people, I'm sure, in Afghanistan.
Absolutely.
Never went. But now, you know, same thing that happened back in the 80s when we helped the Taliban. We, the United States, armed the Taliban against the Russians. You think we're just kind of repeating that process? Wouldn't it be better if they were still throwing rocks?
That's a very good question. I think that's above my pay grade.
Okay. Do you ever feel like enough. They would turn on you?
They did.
Yeah.
Not on me specifically, but they have turned when contractors or Army or the Air Force, when you're training the Afghan police, a lot of them have ran into a ceremony, one in particular in Bagram, and with a suicide vest on. And he killed himself. He killed a bunch of contractors, a bunch of airmen and service personnel, and it was really hard. So it's so hard to determine who's an insurgent and who actually just wants to do better for their country.
Yeah, I hear you. Oh, let me run this by. By the way, we're talking to Paul Yurkin. He's a former Marine, former police officer. His new book, Memoirs of a Security Contractor, comes out when?
Probably the second week of September.
Second week of September is hopefully a release date, and you'll get it where you buy books and Amazon.com. All right, I'm thinking about this. Now, contracting sounded like a great idea to me, but I thought about a business. And you know how...
Oh, God, here we go.
You know how we've got the pirates around the African coast, you know, the shipping lanes and all this stuff. This is a lot safer than going to Afghanistan.
Oh, no.
Right? So I'm thinking about a couple's cruise, right?
Wait for
you
this
take
one.
Your wife. Everybody gets 40 grand to go out there, right? And you get a machine gun mount during the day. Right? You and your wife, you sit out there with a couple of cocktails and a 50, you know, 50 cal. No, 50 cal. 50 cal. It's got to be on the boat. It's got to be a 50 cal. So you and your wife having cocktails, listening to Buffett or whatever, and then all of a sudden, here come the pirates in the inflatable boat. All right, hey, babe, all right, it's your turn, and you get these right here, you know? Hey, yep, oh, gotta lead them.
Shots fired.
Yep. Oh, my God.
Now anticipate the role of the ship, babe. There you go. Good job. Wouldn't that be awesome? And you're getting paid to be out there, you know, tax-free, duty-free.
Sign me up.
Doesn't that sound romantic?
I knew you would do that, Paul.
Sign me up.
I knew you would.
Of course.
All right.
Gosh.
Well, Paul Yurkin, man, great to meet you, man. Again, thank you for your service, brother, both in from the Marine Corps and all you did and the sacrifices you made as a police officer. We really appreciate that. Good luck on your new book, Memoirs of a Security Contractor, coming out a little bit later on Amazon, man. It's good to meet you, man.
Pleasure meeting you. Thank you for your service.
Absolutely. Thank you, brother. All right. Tomorrow, open line Friday. Corby, what else is going on?
Oh, we've got a lot going on Facebook with the kid trying to put his iPhone
into the cassette deck.
Yeah.
That either makes you feel like that kid's a dumbass or we're just old. That's
I think it's both.
Depending on how you look at that. So there's that. And you can always email us tnashowlive.com. Check out our Facebook fan page. Link there from that. And we will catch you guys bright and early tomorrow morning. See you later.
Bye.
You're listening to
that was awesome. That was awesome. Good stuff. Yeah. Let me kill this.
All right.
But that would be really cool.